Today, we are going to be continuing in Romans, and we are going to be in Romans 8, 26 through 30, and we're just going to be continuing our sermon series. So last week, we learned that we have a continuing of hope through the salvation that Paul's talking about. And today, we're going to just see a continuation of that on how the Spirit works through us and how the Spirit really intercedes in our lives. And if you're a note taker, we're going to have 3 points. Those points are weakness, work, and will. And just bear with me, I'm a little unprepared for this morning. I didn't get to prepare as much as I would have liked to, but you know, as cliche as it is, me and Baker were talking about this morning, sometimes you just got to let go and let God take over. So just bear with me through this. So how many of you all have watched any of the ball games going on this week? Or you have a team that you've just been praying for and you want them to win? I know during the Buckeyes game this weekend, I was real excited that we took that over. But you know, sometimes we use prayer as a mechanism for the wrong things in our lives. We use it to try to get what we need instead of, we try to get what we want instead of what we actually need. And we see this as we read, start in chapter 8 in verse 26. It says, "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words." So when it says the Spirit intercedes for us, it really means that the Spirit is acting on our behalf. So we can think of this as Jesus coming down in human form. And the song that we just sang hits the nail on the head on this. The Lamb of God in my place. Jesus came down and poured out his blood so that our sins could be erased for us. And he did that because we are humans and we're weak. We fail every day. And we have a sense of self-entitlement, that everything needs to be about us and nothing needs to be about God. And because of this, it leads us into moments of weakness where we lose focus on what it is that we truly need. And for us to be able to have a vision of what we truly do need from God, we have to have a revelation from him, and we need to see our own sin. And that's where all of our weakness really comes from. It comes from because we are depraved sinners. We're limited in knowledge. We're limited in our understanding of what God has truly done in our lives and the work that he is actually doing in our lives. And when we become limited in all of these areas, we become limited in every facet of our life because we truly see the sin and we need to see the intercession that the Spirit has for us. So as humans, as Christians, we fall short of these every day. We're subdued by temptations. We're subdued by worldly desires. We're greedy. We want money. We focus too much on the things that are ungodly, and we lose the desires that God has for us in our lives. But the way that we get this focus is through our prayer life. So when we're praying, are we asking for the right things? Is our heart in the right place? Are we doing it out of a desire to love God or desire to get what we need for ourselves more so than what God wants us to have for ourselves? So Andrew Murray says it best when he says, "When we pray for the Spirit's help, we will simply fall down at the Lord's feet in our weakness. There we will find victory and power that comes from his love." So during our moments of weakness, we should be falling at the Lord's feet, praying for his guidance and his direction to lead us out of those temptations and out of those worldly desires and to have a heart that's truly focused on him. And then we go to verse 27, and it says, "And he who searches his heart knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God." So through our prayer life, we're constantly having a continual search for what it is that we need from God and what it is that he needs from us. And when we have a better understanding of what Jesus has done on our behalf, it leads to a deeper understanding of to what we need to pray for. And when we pray in times of weakness, it's actually growing our faith and strength because God is giving us the specificity that we need when it comes to our relationship with him. Because we're humans and we don't see what we need, we have to have that continual search through our prayer life in order to get through the struggles, because ultimately God knows what is best. And he knows best because he is a nurturing father, because he loves us, because he wants us to follow him. So those of you who are parents, you know what is best for your children. So when your kid wants something, sometimes you have to say no. So late at night, our four-year-old likes to have milk or likes to have a drink at bedtime. Now, we know it's not best what's best for, because the next morning we may be washing the sheets a little too much. So unfortunately, we know that's not what she needs, but it's what she wants. And it's the same thing with God. We're asking him for things that don't make sense. We're asking him for things that help us more than glorifying him. And we see that through the continual searching and following of our faith, it's going to slowly lead us into that relationship and create those godly desires in our life that we need. And in 2 Corinthians, Paul is going through a moment where he's having a revelation, he's having visions, and he's asking God to just take this thorn out of his side because it's what he wants, but it's not what is best for him at the time. And in 2 Corinthians 12:19, Jesus says to him, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, I am strong." So it is in the depths of our weaknesses, in the depths of our depravity, that our prayer life can make us stronger, because we are leaning on the one who can get us through everything. We're leaning on the one who is the great comforter and the only person that can walk us through our struggles and give us the guidance that we actually need. D.L. Moody says, "Real faith is man's weakness leaning on God's strength." So when we lean on God's strength, we start to see our prayer life and the Spirit interacting with us, and it starts leading us into this relationship and this talking with God that we haven't had before. So think back on the prayers that you've prayed over the years. I was thinking about this as I was going through this yesterday, and some of the prayers that I've prayed over the years, it's kind of embarrassing. Like, you know, it's not focused on what we need in our life to grow our relationship with God. And in Matthew 6:8, when Jesus is teaching his disciples how to pray, he tells them, "Do not be like them, for the Father knows what you need before you ask." So just because we ask for something doesn't mean we're always going to get it, because God always knows what is best. And our second point is work, and it leads us into verse 28, and it says, "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose." Now, I love this verse because this is one of the most misunderstood and misconceptualized verses in the Bible, because it says all things, people like to paraphrase it as all things work for good, but that's not what it's saying. So it's not saying that things work great for everybody. It's not saying that your life is going to be perfect and that things are just going to fall into place for you. There are two specifics in this one verse that we have to focus on. And it says, all things for those who love God. It doesn't say for non-believers. It doesn't say for those who are self-righteous and act like Christians, or who sit in our pews and they pick and choose what we want to believe, and then they go out into the world and they act completely different. It says that those who love God, things work together for good. And we know that not everything is good in our life. Jesus says the exact opposite, actually. Jesus tells us that we will be persecuted because of him and for his sake. We are going to be hated. We are going to be talked about. People are going to question us, and people are going to give us pushback because of our belief and because of our love for God. But because of Jesus coming down and interceding and intervening on our behalf and taking our sin for us and taking the death that we were due, Jesus justifies all of this. And through him, we have the hope of salvation that we learned about last week. And the hope that we're talking about is laid out in the second half of 28, where it says, we are called according to his purpose. So God's purpose is to bring glory to himself. It's to show the glory of God. So we don't live our lives for ourselves. We need to have a continual desire to live for him. We have to live for him. So as Christians, do you know him? Do you truly have that relationship with him? Do you love him? And if you do, are you living every day of your life for him? Outside of these walls, do people know the love that you have for God because of the actions that you're displaying? Do they know because of the words that you're talking about? Do they know because you're there for someone in need and because you're exhibiting the traits of what we need to exhibit as Christians? But the bigger picture is, are we serving in a truly missional way and bringing glory to God and exalting him through everything? Because this is the ultimate purpose that we have. And if we're truly living for God's purpose, we should be outside of our comfort zone. We're not going to glorify him. We're not going to bring his glory to people if we just keep it inside the church. Are we going to the areas of Milton? Or are we going to the areas of Huntington or wherever you may live? Are we putting ourselves in inconvenient places so that God can be shown through them? Because when you're outside your comfort zone, your faith is going to be tested. And through the testing, your faith is just going to grow stronger. Your prayer life is going to grow stronger because you have the ultimate, because you are relying on God to get you through these hardships. And you're relying on him to give you the words that you need to say when you're in these places. And as Christians, we are called to do this. We are called to work and to called to have works. And we don't work because we're faithful. We're not faithful because we work. We work because we are faithful to God. Ephesians 2 says we are called to works because of our faith. And we need to truly understand that. Our faith is only going to grow stronger, which is going to help every other area of our Christian walk, if we're living our true purpose of working for God. And our third point is going to be will. It says, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. So the key word here is conform. So God has predestined us to be conformed to his son. There's so much joy that we need to have from this, because God has chosen us to be his bride. God has chosen us beforehand to be in the image of his son, to draw us near to him. We don't continually seek out God. That's the gospel, is that God continually seeks out us and draws us near to him throughout history and throughout the Bible. Because as humans, that's just not our natural inclination. Our natural propensity is to just run away, as far away as we can, from the grasp of the Father who sent his son to die for us. So we need to have an excitement about this. Our lives need to be surrounded about this because God wants us next to his side. God wants us to be just like his son. And in verse 30, it says, and those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those who he justified, he also glorified. So here, if we read it with what justified and glorified means, we could say, and those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also showed to be right. And those who he showed to be right, he also glorified and praised with admiration. So we were called for a specific reason to our lives as Christians. And this specific reason just goes right back to the purpose that we have in the last point. We are called to live out the will of God. Ephesians 1:5 says, he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will. The kind intention of his will. It's not our will. It's the will of God. And we have to have a desire to conform to what it is that God sees fit for our lives. We can't just go out and do what we want to do, say what we want to say, watch what we want to watch, because that's not the conforming or the transformation that we need as a Christian to be able to have the life that we need to live. But we are also not called to merely sit in the church pews or the seats. It's in complete opposite of what we are called to do. We're called to be doers of the gospel, preachers, ministers. We're called to be disciples. We are called out to bring people to God, not draw people away from God. And this isn't easy, because every day of our life, we get caught up. We get busy. We put God second to everything else when we need to have him on the pedestal, and he needs to be in the forefront, and he needs to be shown and glorified through our actions. We also have to trust God that he's leading us in the direction that he's calling us. We've had a work started in us when Jesus died for us. A work that was started in us because of nothing that we have done, but because of everything that God has done for us. And God is going to continually work in our lives and our hearts to transform and conform to his will and his desires. But we have to listen when he's talking to us, and we have to take notice of what he's saying and the surroundings around us. And are we going to the scriptures? And are we talking to our pastors and getting the direction that they are giving us as well? Because God has brought everybody into our lives for a reason. Every person is going to have an effect on your ministry. And we have to lean on the understanding and not give in to the worldly temptations and the worldly desires that we face every day. And that goes right back to us having a prayer life and that relationship with God. And too often we focus too much on having a wordy prayer. God doesn't care about the wordy prayers. God cares about the relationship he has with you. So, do you have a constant yearning to search for God? Do you have a constant yearning to read your Bible? Do you have a constant yearning to continually develop your prayer life so that you can create that relationship that God wants to have with you? Is your prayer life fervent? Do you know what you're truly asking for? So God doesn't, and it goes back to us putting God in second place. So in reality, it needs to be on full display in our lives. Proverbs 19:21 says, "Many are the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails." So no matter what is in our hearts, no matter what desires, what wicked desires, what temptations, no matter what struggles we are going through, as long as we have God in our lives, his purpose is going to prevail over everything else as long as we fully trust in him. So I want to ask you, do you have a relationship with him? Do you know God? Do you truly have the understanding of the love and the strength that he has to pull you out of any problem that you're going through? Do you talk to him daily? Do you read your Bible daily? Or does your Bible just collect dust on a bookshelf at home and you bring it with you on Sunday morning? So the circumstances that you are in your life, you can get out of those circumstances by drawing yourself near to him. Too often we hear people say that they don't know God, or they can't become a Christian because of where they're at in their life, because they're addicts, or because they have desires in their heart that they don't feel are Christian-like. They put a predication on being a Christian that is not there. Being a Christian and loving God, there's no prerequisites for it. You don't have to be clean. You don't have to have the desires gone. All you have to have is God, and God will draw you out of everything. So as the band starts coming back up, I just want you to think about that. I want you to think about where you are in your life with your prayer life, and I want you to ask yourself, what do you need from it? I want you to ask yourself, do you have the relationship that you should be having with God? Are your thoughts right? Is your prayer life right? Because if not, all you need to do is ask God and draw him into your life.